continue in this vein, hopefully to get done with it today, to get through to the point where we can start teaching about some deficits with GATE. So again, as we start to look at GATE, again, we are looking at first heel strike or initial contact. So heel strike is the traditional terminology. Initial contact would be the Ranchos Los Amigos, and it is the function of what happens as the foot is making contact with the ground. So initial contact or loading response, or initial contact or heel strike. So the heel is coming into striking the ground. The phase would be initial contact. What's all going on there? So at the ankle, again, we said the ankle would be in neutral. Remember, we said the ankle is in neutral, even though the ankle, when you look at the picture above this, this looks like the foot is in dorsiflexion. Can we agree? So from this view, this looks like dorsiflexion. Skeleton's in the way. So that view looks like dorsiflexion. And that would almost be 100% correct, except for the position of the tibia and the fibula. So remember, we talked about open chain versus closed chain movements of dorsiflexion, plantar flexion. So open kinetic chain would be this. I'm sitting, I'm moving my ankle up and down. Whee! Open chain, dorsiflexion, plantar flexion. Closed chain would be my foot is flat, and now I'm moving my tibia over my talus to deal with dorsiflexion, plantar flexion. So in this position here, with my talus directly, with my tibia directly over my talus, this is neutral. We can see that. This looks neutral. Okay? If I move my tibia behind my talus, like so, my tibia is behind my talus, it's the same function as me doing open chain plantar flexion. It's that, an open chain, except it's just closed chain. I'm moving my tibia behind my talus. So this is closed chain plantar flexion. So when my tibia is behind my talus, this is closed chain plantar flexion. And once we get to measuring ankle today, I'll let you see it. We'll stand somebody up on a table and you can see it. And once you see it, you can visualize it better. But this, so when my tibia is behind my talus, like so, then I'm in closed chain plantar flexion. Is no different than me being neutral tibia and pointing my foot down. So if I hold this position and put it down, it looks like that. Make sense? Nobody's lost. Please don't get lost here. Okay. So if I move my tibia, if I move my tibia over my talus, now what am I in? Closed chain dorsiflexion. So this position is no different than this position, except it's closed chain. Matter of fact, if I take this open chain and lay it on the table, it looks like this. So it's no different. It's just closed chain dorsiflexion. So when I'm looking at this photo, the ankle is in closed chain plantar flexion because the tibia is behind the talus. So the talus will be coming here. This is where the line of gravity would be, coming straight up through here. And the tibia is behind the talus. So yes, my foot is in a type of a slight amount of dorsiflexion, but it's offset by my tibia being behind my talus, which is why my ankle is in neutral. So you don't have to go that crazy. I just want to explain to you why it's in neutral. The main things I need you to know for gait, what's the position of each? Ankle, knee, hip. So if it has a specific degrees to it, what's the degrees? Like, is it neutral, 25, 30, 50, whatever it is? You have to know the degrees. Then you need to know what muscles are controlling the action. And then you need to know if it's concentric or eccentric. So those are the three big things I'm going to ask you as it relates to the final about gait. So my goal is to explain it to a degree where all of it makes sense, instead of just giving you a chart and say learning this. But the three things I'm going to want to know is, what is the position, ankle, hip, and knee? What muscles are controlling it? And is it concentric or eccentric? Okay. So the ankle, neutral. It'll be good. You probably want to make a chart, so really help you. Ankle will be in neutral. Muscles controlling it, tibialis anterior and the long toe extensors. That's extensor hallux is longest, extensor digitorum longest. Okay. And it will be concentric. So at the ankle, it's moving concentrically. The long toe flexors are pulling the foot up concentrically. Okay. At the knee, let me go back. Okay, so the knee is going, it's going to be coming down, loading, and it's going to be in slight flexion. So it's going to be in slight flexion because it's trying to offset the ground reaction forces of our foot contacting the ground. Remember when I talked about jumping off of a high surface with your knees straight and how that would make it feel like your knees are about to explode? So same concept with walking. Your knee has to be slightly flexed, which is what you're seeing here, the slight flexion in the knee. The knee is not completely straight. Slight flexion in the knee because it's trying to offset the force of the heel strike. So the knee is in slight flexion, moving to neutral. So it's in about 15 to 20 degrees of flexion, probably a bit less, but it's moving toward extension or neutral. It's trying to move toward neutral. Quadriceps are doing the work, and they're doing it eccentrically. So what that means is the quadriceps is controlling the muscle by moving me up and down. I'm not bending my knee with my hamstrings. I'm lowering myself down with my quads. So just like it would be if you were doing a squat. If you do squats, you're not bending the knee with your hamstrings. You're lowering yourself down with your quads. So quads are moving eccentrically. It shouldn't be moving. I think it says to. Should be moving from. It's moving into slight flexion. Let me write that correctly. I think I wrote. Yeah. So we're going from straight into flexion, a little bit of bend to offset preparation for the loading. So we're going to a little bit of a bend, And the quads are doing it, and they're doing it eccentrically. They're lowering us down into that little bend, eccentric, like you're doing a squat. If you try to do a squat, feel the front of your leg so everybody stand. Don't you worry about it, man. We'll keep you as safe as possible. Okay, so, all right, put your hands on your quadricep muscles. Try to move them around. They should be very easy to move. They're not engaged. Now, keep your hands on your quads. Start going into a squat like you're getting ready to sit into a chair. Now, keep your hands on your quad. Try to move them around. Do they move at all now? No, your quads are engaged. So you are moving into eccentric quadricep produced knee flexion. Your hamstrings aren't bending you down. Your quads are eccentrically contracting, lowering you down. Does that make sense? So the hamstrings aren't doing this, bending the knee. I'm bending the knee because my quads are on and they're lowering me down eccentrically. Okay, thank you, thank you. So ankle, neutral, tib anterior, long toe extensors, concentrically. Knee is moving into slight flexion from extension. So when we come out of swing, we're in full extension. And now we're going into slight flexion on heel strike or initial contact. And that's being done by the quads eccentrically. Wait, sir? Mm-hmm. You can turn it in, Mr. Jonna. Second door down. So that's eccentric. The hip and pelvis are in what we would say is 25 degrees of hip flexion, and the pelvis is 5 degrees rotated. So 25 degree, my hip is flexed. So my hip is in flexion. So that's hip flexion. This would be neutral hip. This is a flexed hip. So I'm in 25 degree hip flexion, 5 degree rotation. And the reason I'm there is because my glute max and my hamstrings are contracting isometrically. So on initial contact, those are the three areas we're concerned with. These are the only three areas we're concerned with, period. But this is what's happening at the three areas. Those are the things I want you to know. What's the movement? What muscles are producing it? And how are they doing it? Concentrically, eccentrically, isometrically. Okay. Next, foot flat or loading response. Now we're trying to get the foot flat on the ground so we can start to load this leg because the other leg is moving into swing. So now I'm about to be single leg on the ground, so I need to be able to load this leg. So I have to get it to the ground where the whole foot is flat. Okay, foot flat from the ankle. My ankle is moving it's gonna move into a rapid 15 degrees of plantar flexion. So I go from being neutral to now my foot is flat and my tibia is still behind my talus. So when you look at it, your foot is flat, yes. So the foot is flat, but your tibia is still behind your talus, which is right here. So the talus will be coming right about there with the ankle. So now I'm in still about 15 degrees of plantar flexion. So on foot flat, I'm in what's called 15 degrees of plantar flexion. And that's because even though my foot is flat, my tibia is still behind my talus a bit. So about 15 degrees of plantar flexion. This will be neutral, 15 degrees. The reason I'm in that is because now the same muscles before, tib anterior, extensor hallucis, extensor digitorum, are contracting eccentrically to lower my foot to the ground. So the muscles on the front of my legs are contracting to lower my foot to the ground. They're controlled lowering my foot. So even though I'm in plantar flexion, my calf muscles aren't contracting at all. What's contracting are my anterior muscles, tib anterior, extensor hallucis, extensor digitorum. They're contracting and they're lowering my foot to the ground eccentrically. Okay. Don't worry about the late phase gastrocnemia shit. We'll get to that. So, foot flat or loading response, I'm moving into 15, I'm going from neutral to 15 degrees of plantar flexion. I'm getting there because my pre-tibial muscles or my anterior muscles, tib anterior, extensor hallucis, extensor digitorum, it's lowering my foot flat to the ground eccentrically. My knee, again, is flexing a little bit more because it's now taking on more weight. So it's moving from, again, that extension with a little bit of flexion. It's like 5 degrees on loading on initial contact or heel strike to now loading response is bending a little more to about 15 to 20 degrees. So the knee is giving in a little bit more. It's trying to absorb that shock when I'm walking. Quads are still contracting eccentrically to do this. Okay. So that's the whole goal of the knee, shock absorption. And we do shock absorption through flexing the knee and the quads contracting eccentrically. Quads eccentric contraction. The hip and pelvis, I'm now moving into hip extension. Hip extension. So now let's make that make sense. If my leg is, if this is my initial contact leg here, so same concept, my trunk is, I'm in hip flexion here. So if you measure this, if you laid me down, it would be about a 25 degree angle from my hip flexion. Lateral knee here, there, it's about 25 degrees. Now when my foot goes flat, my body is starting to come more over my hip, and that is shortening the hip flexion angle. Does that make sense? So instead of my hip being here,
come here, fella.
So when I'm stretched out like this, this is about a 20 degree angle. Now, once I pull my body forward over that, now I'm shortening that angle and making it go into hip extension. So it's closed chain hip extension. So I'm moving from 25 degrees from heel strike to now 15 degrees at foot flat. So I'm moving into hip extension. I'm still in a little bit of hip flexion, but I'm going from 25 to 15. I'm moving toward hip extension. What's helping this? Erector spinae, the long muscles in the back, glute max, hamstrings, act as hip extensors to do the job. TFL and glute med and glute min are also contracting concentrically to help stabilize my pelvis because I don't need my pelvis shifting from side to side when I'm trying to load my leg. You can imagine how unstable you would feel if you tried to load your leg shaking from side to side. So let's try it. Let's have some fun with it. Okay, so what I want you to do, you're going to take one leg, stretch it out in front of you, foot flat. So the foot is going to be flat, just like that. Now, what I want you to do, shift your hips from side to side. Keep going. Now, try to stand on that one leg that's in the front. Keep going from side to side. See how easy that is. See if you can do it. No, your body wants to collapse. So we need the pelvis stable. If the pelvis is not stable, then that side-to-side movement is going to cause the knee to buckle. So we need TFL, glute me, glute men, to contract to hold the pelvis stable. So erector spinae, glute max, hamstrings are controlling the leg. They're controlling the hip extension, pulling me from 25 to 15. TFL, glute me, glute men are contracting to hold my pelvis stable. Okay, so those are the incidents of loading response or foot flat. Okay, now we're in mid stance. And it's the same name for both, mid stance. Now we're in mid stance. Now the opposite foot is completely off the ground and is in swing. So the leg opposite the stance leg is in full swing. So now we're having to make sure this leg is stable and able to take the body weight. So at the ankle, I'm coming out of plantar flexion, closed chain, into dorsiflexion, closed chain. And the way I'm doing that is my tibia goes from being behind my talus, tibia talus, right here at the foot, to now being over my talus. Like so. See, mid stance, I'm now, my tibia is now directly over it or a little bit in front of it, of my talus. So I went from here to here. Closed chain plantar flexion. The way this is happening is due to momentum, shockingly. So I know this is going to sound crazy. When you start walking, your body moves by momentum. It's not so much muscle movement once it gets moving. So momentum is doing most of the job as it relates to mid stance. It's because we've gotten that heel rocker motion, got our foot down and we rocked onto it. That's that motion there lets momentum do the work so that we can just move forward. So our job as it relates to mid stance is to slow down gait so it doesn't happen too fast and cause us to take a shortened step. So we want it to be long enough to be able to take a normal step instead of getting too fast and we look like we're limping. So we need to slow it down. And the gastrocnemius and the soleus contract eccentrically to slow down the speed of gait, so that it's not happening too fast. Momentum is going to want to take it fast. We need to slow it down. You ever see movies where horses are running out of control and somebody j- jumps on their backs and pull the reins, and they start to slow down. Whoa, horsey, whoa. The horse slows down. Same concept. Gastrocnemius is slowing that thing down so that everything happens normally. Okay? So we're moving into dorsiflexion. The motion is into dorsiflexion. We're moving into 5 degrees of dorsiflexion. Mid stance. Momentum is doing the work because of the heel rocker motion. We'll come back to that, don't worry. So momentum is doing the work due to the heel rocker. And our job from a muscle standpoint is to slow the process down so that we can have a normal step. And gastroc soleus does that, slows it down, contracting eccentrically. Okay, so the knee goes from being a shock absorber on loading response to now being a stability port so that this leg can swing. So in mid stance, the knee is going to go from 15 degrees of flexion, shock absorption, to now full extension or neutral. Not hyperextension, not recurvatum, extension, 0 degrees. So the knee is moving into 0 degrees at mid stance. Here is why 0 is the necessary number. At 0 degrees, something awesome happens to the knee. Anybody willing to take a guess on it? It's a word you've learned so far. Begins with an S. When we get the knee into 0 degrees, we get that medial femoral rotation on the tibia and it locks out the knee. Screw home happens. Now, why is screw home so important? I'm glad you asked. During mid stance, your quads turn completely off. You're not getting any quad contraction helping to hold your knee straight during mid stance. Quads are off. In case you don't believe it, let's prove it. So, stand. Okay, so let your leg relax. Just kind of hold it out in front of you. Palpate your quad muscles. Move them around there. There you go. You can feel how loose they are. Now, squeeze your quad, try to move it around. Feel what it feels like when the quad is contracted. Very good, you know what that feels like. Now, take that same leg, and I want you to stand on that leg. Now, try to move your quads. It's movable. A little bit of muscle, but it's pretty movable. When you get the knee fully straight and bend from your hip, you really feel it. It's mobile. See, I can move my quad. My quad isn't locked in. So in mid stance, my quads are not contracting to help to hold my knee in this neutral position. Screw home is. The locking mechanism of the knee holds me in knee extension. So I need to be able to get my knee straight so that screw home can engage and lock my knee so that I can swing my other leg. Okay, you can sit. So quads are not working in mid stance, even though most people would think that. I got to get quads strong so I can do mid stance. I can stand on one leg and do it. No, you need to get the knee straight so it locks. The knee has to lock. Screw home has to happen. The only muscles contracting at the knee during mid stance are your hamstrings contracting to prevent genu recurvatum, trying to prevent your knee from going into hyperextension. So that's what's happening at the knee. Screw home stabilizes the knee once we get it into knee extension, 0 degrees of knee extension, where it locks, and hamstrings are contracting to help prevent genu recurvatum, hyperextension. And we'll show you that type of knee when you watch people with stroke gaits walk, because they have a lot of genu recurvatum. Their hamstrings don't contract to stop that action from happening. Okay. Hip and pelvis. The hip extends to neutral. So now we're moving from a level of hip flexion, like we saw here, and loading response. So that's still hip flexion. Now the trunk is continuing to move forward over the leg, and that's going to pull us now into hip extension. So the hip is now in extension. Zero degrees. And the main function at the hip, we need this to happen so that the opposite leg can perform its swing function. So the non-weight bearing leg is swinging past the mid-stance leg. Glute med and glute minimus are the primary muscles contracting at the hip, and they are contracting to prevent the opposite side hip from dropping. So, glute med, let me write that down because I don't want you lost here, because I'm going to spend some time explaining this, because people fall off the cliff on this one every year. I don't know why. So I'm going to make sure we get this. So, on the stance leg, in mid stance, glute med minimus contract to prevent the opposite pelvis from dropping. Okay. Now, let's help that make sense. Because I know you're thinking, this guy is an idiot. How does glute med prevent me from having my pelvis drop? Okay, so let's make some stuff make sense. Okay, can everybody see me well? This is important. Okay, so if I take my right leg and I do this, describe this motion. Hip abduction. Right hip abduction. We all agree? Nobody disagrees. Right hip is moving into abduction. If I wanted to do that closed chain, what would I do? So if I keep my foot here and I move my trunk away, what is that? Is my right leg away from the midline, or is it closer to the midline? It's away from the midline. I agree. So this, so let me move it away a little bit more so you really can see it. This is the same thing as this, just closed chain. Right hip abduction, closed chain, right hip abduction. So this would be the middle line. My leg is away from the center point. Make sense? Closed chain, right hip abduction. We're okay there. Nobody lost. Okay. If I pull my leg across my body, what would you call that? Adduction. Right hip adduction. Okay. If I'm standing and now I shift my hip that way, how would you describe that? Closed chain, right hip adduction. So my leg, if you measured it, would be coming into the midline. So here, neutral. When I shift my pelvis, adduction. Okay, stand. Let's practice this so your brains can wrap around what we're saying. So start with open chain abduction. Everybody, very good. Very good. Now, lock your right leg in place. Now, shift your pelvis to the left. Is your leg away from the midline or closer to the midline? It's away. So let's prove it. So hold this position. Everybody hold this position. Lock your leg. Tighten your quads, lock your leg. Don't let it move. Lock it. Now, use your left leg and stand straight up and see what position your leg is in. What position are you in? Abduction, right? You didn't change anything. All you did was went from closed chain to open chain. We get it? Make sense? Don't get lost here. This is vital. This will help you understand gait, I swear to you. You'll be able to explain this better than PT students. I swear, they cannot explain this stuff. They'll go, yeah, Trendelenburg, the hip drops. They don't know why. You'll get why. I'm trying to help you with the why. So this is the same thing as this. You straighten the leg, it's the same thing. Closed chain, open chain, abduction. That's all we did. Okay, foot down again. Now, bring your leg across your body. Adduction, we feel that. Now, lock your right foot in. Shift your pelvis all the way over to the right side. Is your hip more lateral than your foot? So if my hip is more lateral than my foot, then I am in closed chain adduction. Make sense? So this, when my hip, this hip bone is more lateral, if I run a line down, it would be here. My foot is way in here. So I'm in closed chain adduction, adduction. Make sense? Okay, so it's hard to remake that one standing up straight, so that's why we can't do it, but it's the same concept. Okay, so you get that. Open chain, closed chain, ab and adduction. We get that, okay. Nobody lost there. Good Lord, it got hot quick. Perfect, okay. Now, let's talk about Trendelenburging or the hip dropping. Okay, so when I go into mid stance on my right foot, mid stance on my right foot, glute med and glute minimus are contracting to help keep my hip in neutral. So let me say that again. When I am in mid stance, stance leg, glute, med, minimus, contract to hold me in neutral. What does glute, med, and glute, med do? What is their assignment? What are their action? Abduction. I agree. They are hip abductors. Okay? So we get that. So when I'm on my stance leg, glute med, glute med are contracting concentrically to help my hip stay in neutral. They are fighting an abduction to prevent me from going into stance leg pelvis adduction. Make sense? It's contracting to help hold me in neutral so I don't go into closed chain hip adduction. Now, if they don't contract and I fall into closed chain hip adduction on my right, it's going to cause my left pelvis to drop. Does that make sense? So let's try it. So everybody try to stand again. So. All right, so don't go crazy with it, but I want you to go in a single leg stance on your right. Now, go into right side hip closed chain adduction. Poke that hip out. Which hip is dropped? The left one is down, isn't it? We agree? So the left one is down, meaning it's going to now be harder for me to swing my left leg. That's called Trendelenburg. So glute med, glute med have to contract on the stance leg because they're holding me in neutral, stopping me from going into closed chain hip adduction, which would cause my swing leg pelvis to drop. So my stance leg muscles are contracting to prevent my opposite pelvis from dropping. That makes sense? I promise you, you have so much wisdom now. You won't even believe it because you get it. You get it. Hopefully you'll get it. Okay, so that's what's happening in mid stance at the hip. I'm moving into neutral or 0 degrees, and the muscles that are contracting, glute med, glute med, as abductors of my hip to help hold me in neutral to prevent my hip from falling into closed chain hip adduction. Let me write that. To prevent closed chain hip adduction. that's the whole goal. That's what it's trying to prevent. Closed chain hip adduction. Because if I find myself there, my pelvis on the opposite side is going to drop. All right, that's a good place to take five. We'll pause it. We'll come back and get through the rest of stance. Hopefully we can even move into swing some. Hopefully this is making sense. Yes, ma'am. Neither. So, I mean, quads aren't contracting at all. The gastroc soleus is contracting eccentrically to slow it down at the knee. So, eccentrically, so it's really just gastroc, but soleus, but a soleus is helping, but gastroc is the one that crosses the knee. But yeah, it's contracting eccentrically to slow gait down. We're trying to slow that puppy down. Momentum is making it happen, and it does it fast. Good question. Mm-hmm. Yep, so mid stance, yep. Gastroc soleus. So more gastroc. And more, oh, you mean the hamstrings? So hamstrings are contracting concentrically to prevent recurvatum. Like quads aren't on at all. Gastroc is controlling knee and ankle. Soleus helps to control ankle. Hamstrings concentric to control the knee from recurvatum. So they're contracting to stop the knee from going into hyperextension. Great question. Great, great question. Okay, any other questions? These are good. I want you guys to get it. Gait. Mid stance. Now we're moving into terminal stance or heel off. Now we're about to pick the heel up because we're about to put the other foot down. So now we're getting ready to move this, our stance leg, into the swing leg by putting the other foot down and going through these processes. So when we're in heel off, so I was in about 15 degrees of dorsiflexion. Now I'm moving into a rapid 5 degrees of plantar flexion. So remember mid stance, I am dorsiflexed. My tibia is over my talus, so I'm neutral. The position of my leg is neutral, or 5 degrees of dorsiflexion. Now in heel off, I now lift the heel up. And now that puts me into plantar flexion. That is plantar flexion. So if we ask you to do plantar flexion, you would do this. So that's how we're now in plantar flexion. So we're in about 5 degrees of plantar flexion. We pick the heel up off the ground. My metatarsal phalangeal joints of my foot are going to extend to about 30 degrees. So my toes are extending to allow for plantar flexion. Okay. And that's still being controlled by gastroc soleus eccentrically. So it's Gastroc soleus eccentrically. The knee continues to remain in extension. Steel screw home is doing that. Calf muscles are helping to keep it slowed down. Gastrocnemius. So gastroc soleus is doing a lot. Screw home is keeping the knee locked out. Gastrocnemius soleus are controlling a lot of the motions at this point. Now my hip moves from 0 degrees where it was in neutral. So that's a vertical angle here. It's in 0 degrees here, mid stance. Now my swing leg has moved in front of my body, putting my pelvis in front of my leg, moving this leg now into hip extension. So we were neutral, because remember, when you're measuring the hip angle, your fulcrum is over, what is over? Frotted troch, moving arm, lateral epicondyle, very good. Stabilizing arm is in line with the trunk or the pelvis, very good. So now, if this is my hip angle, this is a zero angle, if I stretch this leg out, my trunk is more forward than my leg. So now I'm in closed chain hip extension, here, there. Does that make sense? So the leg is behind the body, causing me to be in closed chain hip extension. So at the hip, I'm now moving into hip extension. About 20 degrees of hip extension. And momentum is doing that work as well, because the swing limb is moving the trunk forward. So heel off is a whole lot of momentum and trying to slow things down. It's being slowed down at the ankle by the gastroc soleus, slowed down at the knee by gastroc. Momentum is doing the work in the hip. Okay, now we're not just getting the heel off, now we're starting to get the toes off the ground. We're about to pick this leg up and get ready to swing it. So in toe off, I'm going into more plantar flexion. So now the heel is off the ground. So even though we're here, we're in about 20 degrees of plantar flexion. The MTP joints extend even more to about 60 degrees. Okay. Calf muscles starting to turn off, so now they don't need to limit the motion anymore. They're not slowing things down anymore. Flexor hallucis longus is now contracting here concentrically to help cause the ankle to move into plantar flexion, because it's one of the only parts of the foot that's still on the ground. The lateral foot is off the ground. So flexor digitorum wouldn't be really effective. Tibialis posterior wouldn't be really effective. Really the big toe is one of the main structures that's still on the ground. Flexor hallucis longus. The knee is moving from extension to 40 degrees of flexion, because we're going to need to flex the knee to swing it. It's created by weight shifting to the opposite side now that the other leg is in loading response. So we shift the weight from loading response, and that's what causes the knee to flex. Rectus kicks in eccentrically to make sure we don't bend the knee too fast from the momentum of shifting off the leg. Only if needed. Okay. Okay. And those are all of our stance phase activities. It's everything from stance phase. So the only thing we have now, the hip. So the hip is moving, it was in 20 degrees in toe off, 20 degrees of extension. Now it's starting to move back forward to go into swing, so it comes back to 0 degrees. Comes back into neutral alignment. Yep, here we go. So you can see the hip now is in alignment with the stance leg. Nope, hang on. Here we go. Now, the hip is now in alignment. It came forward. Was in extension, now it's back in line with the stance leg, or with the leg that just came down. Okay. And iliopsoas and rectus are the primary ones contracting to help to flex the hip and bring it forward. What gives us the motion to come forward as we're getting ready to toe off, to go into swing. That's why we call iliopsoas the primary flexor of the hip. Okay. Acceleration. Now we're moving into swing phase. Now this leg is swinging through. The goal is no longer to be the stance leg, but it's to swing through so that it can come down and be the stance leg again. So we're trying to swing it through. So there's only three phases of swing: acceleration or initial swing. The ankle moves into dorsiflexion. So the ankle is moving into dorsiflexion from plantar flexion. So it was in plantar flexion on pre-swing. Now it's moving into rapid dorsiflexion so that we can clear the ground. So I need dorsiflexion so I can clear the ground. It's really hard to walk with your foot in plantar flex. It's gonna trip all the time. So now I need dorsiflexion. Dorsiflexor muscles, the pretibial muscles, tib anterior, and the two long toe extensors contract concentrically to lift the foot and swing. The knee is flexing even more to about 60 degrees. Short head of biceps femoris, sartorius, and gracilis are doing the work. Hamstrings aren't doing as much work as we think. Initial swing's job is to clear the foot So we're getting ready to try to clear the foot. Pelvis flexes to about 15 degrees. Iliopsoas, the long adductor, gracilis and sartorius helps with that. Initial swing. Then mid swing, so we're in the middle of swinging now. This is actually clearing the foot so that it's moving the foot past the other leg so that we can go into terminal swing. Ankle moves from 10 degrees of dorsiflexion to about neutral, so we get a little bit more plantar flexion. We're trying to hold it in neutral. Still those same muscles contracting to do it. This allows for foot clearance, which happens by about 1 centimeter. So during mid swing, when we're swinging the foot through to get ready to when we're walking, we only clear the ground about 1 centimeter. That's pretty cool. So it's not a whole lot. 1 centimeter. The knee is flexing even more to about 65 degrees. Then once we get through mid, once we get to the late phases of mid swing, the knee is going to rapidly extend in the late phases to about 25 degrees. So it's going to flex up to 65 initially and then extend down to 25. So we can start getting ready to put it down on the ground for heel strike. Okay, no muscles, momentum, and gravity. Hip and pelvis, we're flexing it even more because we're stretching out, trying to go into the heel strike position. So we're stretching out further for heel strike. So 25 degrees of hip flexion is where we're heading to there. And now is when we finally see the hamstrings assisting with swing, and they fire to slow the tibia down. So momentum is making the tibia swing. The hamstrings fire to make sure it doesn't swing too fast and too far. They slow the tibia down. Then terminal swing or deceleration, this is the phase where we're getting ready to put the heel on the ground to go into initial contact or heel strike. Ankle is in neutral, pretibial concentric. The knee is heading to neutral or extended. So that's where we'll find it on initial contact before it goes into the flexion. Quads contracting concentrically to help make sure that the knee stays in extension. Hamstrings are contracting eccentrically to slow the leg down to make sure it doesn't go too far too fast. Anybody here ever been on a plane? Good. If you've ever been on a flight, it'll make sense. Imagine the leg as the airplane getting ready, as the airplane touching down on the runway. So you're flying. The pilot touches down on the runway, throws the brakes. You can hear all the air letting out of the brakes. Plane slows down. Same concept with the hamstring on terminal swing. It's trying to slow the leg down like the brakes on an airplane. Okay. And then our hip and pelvis moves to about 25 degrees of hip flexion, the position it'll be found in for initial contact. Okay. Adductor magnus, glute max are the two that are contracting to to help with weight acceptance on initial contact as we're putting the leg down. Okay. So that's kind of what we went through with all of that. Okay. I'll mention a couple, and then we will give you a break for lunch. We'll just go through kind of age-related so that we can start back on common gait deviations. It says pathology causes changes to our gait characteristics. Walking patterns of toddlers, adults, and elderly have different characteristics. Gait characteristics of a toddler will change as they neuromuscularly mature. So as they start to get more nerve connections and the nervous system communicates better, then the toddler gait will change. And also as their height increases. Toddlers walk with a wide base of support, a faster cadence, and shorter stride length. They initially hit the ground in what's called foot flat. They don't do heel strike. So let's show you a toddler's gait. Okay. So watch as he walks back, his gait is wider. He has a wide base of support. It's going to be really fast, short strides, and he's coming down on foot flat. He's not heel strength. Choppy. Keep your cue in front.
Very wide base.
Very big pads. And as they mature, this will get better. The base of support, so when it says base of support, it's talking about the width of the feet. So they have a wide width of feet because they are trying to keep their balance. They're going to have a faster cadence. They're going to walk faster. And they don't land on heel strike, they land in foot flat. So toddler gait is very specific. Okay. And they walk in what we call high guard position. So when you walk, your arms are swinging down by your side. Cool. When they walk, their arms are up here, high guard. That's helping them to keep their balance. That's why they walk with their arms up. Like that. That's why they walk like that. It's called high guard. It's a real thing. Toddler gait. It's really cool. It's really cute. It's funny. So, it will improve as they age. With adults, they exhibit some odd gait patterns as well. As adults age and become elderly, gait characteristics change. Not every elderly person demonstrates the same changes, but there are some typical ones. They will accommodate for poor balance or fear of falling by widening their base of support, kind of like a toddler. Won't be as wide, but it'll be a bit wider. Decrease muscle strength interferes with lifting the foot high enough off the ground to clear it. This will increase the potential for tripping and falling. So they don't have the pretibial muscle strength, tib anterior and the long toe extensors to lift, which gives them a chance of catching their toe on a structure and falling. Okay. They have a decrease in walking speed, and it increases the length of double stance time. Pelvic rotation is decreased and walking speed decreases. So they walk slower. Okay. All righty. So those are some good indicators for that. All right, when we come back from lunch, we'll talk about some gait deviations. We'll spend about 30 minutes on that, and then we'll start working on measuring the ankle for goniometry and preparing you for that. All right, call it a break. Get you some lunch.